Thank you, Your Honor. The state calls Nicole Mackenzie.
Raise your right hand. You swear or affirm under penalty of perjury that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, that nothing but the truth.
Yes, Your Honor.
Let's see. And if you feel comfortable doing so, we'd prefer that you take your mask off.
Certainly.
And before you begin, actually, have you got any of that stylus that's in there? Thank you. That'll be falling for you. Oh. If you could begin by giving us your full name, spelling each of your names.
Nicole Mackenzie, N-I-C-O-L-E. Last name Mackenzie, M-A-C-K-E-N-Z-I-E.
Mr. Solicitor.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
How are you employed?
I'm employed by the Minneapolis Police Department.
How long have you been employed by the police department?
About 6 years.
And what is your current role there?
I am a police officer.
Do you have a specific duty assignment?
I do. I am the medical support coordinator for the department.
All right. Now, before we talk about that role, I'd like you to share a little bit about yourself with the jury. How long, then, have you been a police officer or in law enforcement?
I've been in law enforcement for about 6 years, all of that whole time with the Minneapolis Police Department.
And did you have a career prior to going into law enforcement?
I did, yes. I worked in human resources.
Okay. What's your educational background?
I have an associate's degree in human resources. I have a bachelor's degree in business. I am an EMT. I also have my law enforcement certificate, and I'm also an EMR instructor.
You worked in human resources. That was your original plan?
Correct.
How long have you wanted to be a police officer?
Actually, it's something I had always wanted to do. I just kind of talked myself out of it for one way or another, but eventually found my way back.
Can you please tell the jury how you entered law enforcement? Did you go through the academy?
I did, yes. I came in as a cadet, which means that the department sponsors the education components that make you eligible for the post-exam in the state of Minnesota.
And how long of a program was that?
I think it was about 9 months total.
After you completed the in-class or the classroom portion of the academy, did you go through field training?
I did.
How long was that process?
The field training at that time was about 5.5 to 6 months. Okay.
And as an officer with the Minneapolis Police Department, are you familiar with some of the officers who also work in the department?
I am.
Are you familiar with the name Derek Chauvin?
I am.
How are you familiar with that name?
He was actually one of my fill-in FTOs for one day. While I was on FTO, I think my FTO was sick, but also he's attended my training that I've conducted with the department.
All right. And would you recognize him if you saw him?
Yes.
Do you see him in the courtroom today?
Yes, sir.
Would you please point to him and describe what he's wearing?
Yep. So the gentleman here in the light gray suit.
All right. May the record reflect the witnesses identified the defendant?
Any objection? It will.
You indicated that you're the medical support coordinator, is that right?
Yes, sir.
Could you please describe for the jury what that role entails?
Certainly. There's a couple different components to it. Primarily, it's going to be the first aid education that all of the officers receive. I do the training for the academy, both the recruits and the cadets, as well as the in-service, which is more like the continuing ed for all of the current officers. And I am also administrator of the Narcan program that we have.
What is the Narcan program?
The Narcan program is the training and administration of a pharmaceutical to use to temporarily reduce opiate overdoses.
And is Narcan, is that something that officers have available to them?
Yes, sir.
And you provide the specific training regarding the use of Narcan?
So I do.
Okay. And also, you provide medical training both at the academy and in service, is that right?
Correct.
Are you familiar with the requirements from the department and the post requirements for how often officers are supposed to train in medical procedures?
Yeah, with the Minnesota Post Board, when you're able to apply for the examination, you do have to have your EMR certification, and that's emergency medical responder. Beyond that, the Post Board doesn't require anything terribly specific, but with the Minneapolis Police Department, we do continuing education every year on medical-related topics.
You said that the Post Board doesn't require anything more specific. Can you explain that?
With their education requirements as far as the continuing ed, as long as you've met the minimum number of hours, there are certain topics that they require you to complete. Other ones, because with the Minneapolis Police Department, we go above and beyond what the Post Board requires. So that's where we add in extra medical training.
And you do that every year?
We do.
Are police officers required to have a specific CPR card?
Not a card, no. You're not required to have that beyond your initial post certification.
When you're initially post certified, you need one.
Correct. And that's a part of the EMR certification that's required to be eligible to take the post exam.
And some officers will continue to obtain the CPR card, is that right?
Correct.
You know what is required in order to obtain that card?
It's about a 4-hour class. There's a written test and a skills examination test out.
And what does it cover?
It includes adult CPR and AED, infant CPR, AED, as well as choking.
Now, at this time, I'd like to display to the witness, and not to the jury, Exhibit 277 for identification. You take a look at what's been marked for identification as Exhibit 277. Does that appear to be an American Heart Association CPR AED card?
Correct, yes.
Is that the type of card that you get issued if you complete the 4-hour course you just mentioned?
Yes.
While it's not required, some officers continue them, and those cards are maintained in the records of Minneapolis Police Department. Is that right?
If they had taken a full AHA course through the Minneapolis Police Department, we would be the record holder.
All right. And then if we can take a look at Exhibit 278, that also appeared to be a CPR card, just of a different year?
Correct.
Okay, I'm going to offer Exhibits 277 and 278.
Any objection?
277 and 278 are received.
If we could publish Exhibit 277 and highlight the portion. Does this appear to be a Heart Saver CPR AED card issued to Derek Chauvin, March 2012 through March 2014?
Correct.
Okay. And if we could display Exhibit 278. Again, a CPR card issued to the defendant from January 2014 to January 2016. Is that right?
That's correct.
And then when you provide the training, medical training to law enforcement officers, does that training get reported into the workforce system to be able to report to the Post Board?
It does.
Now, when did you start personally delivering this training?
I have been a part-time instructor since 2017, and I assumed the full-time position January of 2020.
Okay. How many times do you think that you've provided this training, this in-service training to law enforcement officers?
CPR specifically?
Yes.
I would say upwards of 20 to 30 sessions.
All right. Do you use a slide deck or a PowerPoint to do your medical presentation every year?
We do.
If I can show you Exhibit 111, just to the witness, not to the jury. Exhibit 111, do you recognize what appears to be the first part of a slide deck?
Yes.
And if we can turn to the second page of 111, does that appear to have, it says MPD CPR, is that right?
Correct.
Have you personally delivered this slide deck before?
I have.
approximately how many times?
This was in service of 2019, and my best estimation, this was probably carried out over the course of maybe 12 sessions or so, 12 to 15 sessions, and I was responsible for about a third of them.
Right. Did the defendant attend any of your sessions?
I'm not sure.
But you were providing the block of training that everyone consistently took back in the in-service in 2019?
Correct. I was the assistant instructor here, and I ran one of the skill stations. So theoretically, everybody from the department would have come through my skill station at some point.
Now, at this time, if I can, you can take that down here. I'm going to offer Exhibit 111.
Any objection? 111 is received.
In general terms, then, can you provide the jury an overview of the specific medical training that you provide to law enforcement officers on an annual basis?
For in-service, specifically?
For in-service, yes.
Okay. We do offer a wide variety of different kind of trainings, depending on how many training sessions are going to be available to us in a year. But at a minimum, every year we are touching on CPR and AED. And then in alternate years, we're also going over a refresher class on Narcan. Okay. And that's the minimum standard. If we have more training spots available to us, we can add in more classes.
And are you aware whether the Minneapolis Police Department has a specific policy regarding rendering of emergency aid?
We do.
And could you please provide the jury just a high-level overview of what that policy requires?
Certainly. It's a high-level summary of our first aid policy is going to be requesting EMS resources to anybody that needs it or anybody who requests it, and also rendering first aid that's consistent with your training that you've received.
Okay. And does the policy allow you to do one or the other? Can you just call for the ambulance and not do the emergency medical procedures?
It depends on the situation specifically. If there was really no need for immediate first aid, maybe like a small cut or abrasion, you know, it would be then appropriate to just wait for EMS to arrive. But if it's a critical situation, you have to do both.
I'd like you now to kind of walk us through some of the specific training that you provide, and we'll use Exhibit 111 to do so. If you could publish Exhibit 111, starting at page 6. Well, let's go back to page 1. All right, why don't you explain page 1 of this?
Okay, so this is an image of a clip that's taken from the classic movie Dumb and Dumber. And this is a video clip that we show at the very beginning of training. It's more or less just kind of a lighthearted way to get people a little bit more engaged in the class, as...
Not a substantive slide.
No, absolutely not.
All right. Now, I'd like to then cover the substantive portions. If you could go to page 6 and review the portion of the slide deck that says agenda. You please describe to the jury each of these different portions of the training that you provide.
Certainly. So this block of training was primarily focused on CPR, but we did throw in a couple of extra pieces of information because we had the time available to us. So we just kind of briefly retouched on other things we had had already taught, which was tactical combat casualty care. That's basically rendering aid for more traumatic injuries, if you will. And then we also provided an update on our Narcan program as far as usage and maybe things we had learned since we had initially had rolled it out. And then the remainder of the time was focused on the full CPR course.
All right. If you could go to page 21 of Exhibit 111. And for the jury, would you please describe, then using this slide, just kind of walk us through what specific training you provide Minneapolis Police Department as it pertains to CPR?
Okay. When we're called to a scene where there is some kind of medical situation going on, maybe it's illness or injury, whatever it happens to be, we have a little bit of a mnemonic that we always kind of walk through to make sure that we're covering all the basics. So when you're encountering somebody that appears to be unconscious, we start with an acronym that's called AVPU. That's A-V-P-U. We walk through that acronym to determine a level of responsiveness. And then we kind of work through the A, Bs, and Cs, which is airway, breathing, and circulation.
Great. I'd like you to then please go to the next page, 22. AVPU, could you please walk the jury through this assessment tool?
Certainly. So when you're determining somebody's level of responsiveness, you kind of walk through this as your model to see where they land. So if somebody's alert, that means that, you know, as soon as I walk into the room, like, and they spontaneously look at me, I determine, okay, that person's alert. I don't really need to go any further. Verbal would be, you know, maybe just kind of yelling towards somebody or trying to get their attention, something like that, to see if they respond to any verbal stimuli. And if you don't get a response there, then you move on to the P, which is pain. And that's going to be like something like, for instance, you know, if you grab like the base of the fingernail and kind of press against it, you're just kind of looking for any kind of like response that somebody would like normally like pull away from. We're certainly not talking about anything that would, you know, cause any injury per se, but just a little pain stimulus, see if they kind of pull away from you or something like that. And if they don't respond, then you determine that person is unresponsive.
Right. I'd like to just talk about, have you talk about the P, the painful stimuli, briefly. It sounds like in the assessment tool, what the person is doing, the trainee is doing, is going to be applying a painful stimulus to see if the person reacts. Is that right?
That's correct.
Is it possible to determine someone's level of responsiveness without intentionally, or should I say, without inflicting pain for the purpose of checking stimuli? So, for example, just observing whether the person is continuing to react to some kind of painful stimulus.
Can you rephrase that?
Sure. If someone, if you came upon an individual who was injured, for example, mm-hmm. and crying out or manifesting some sort of pain as a result of the injury, but at some point they stop being verbal, they stop responding to that pain, could that potentially be a sign of non-responsiveness?
Correct, yes.
Okay. Once you determine an individual is unresponsive, then what do you do?
Then you walk through the next set of acronyms, which is going to be your A, Bs, and Cs.
If you could return to page 21, please. Okay. And A, Bs, and Cs, that's airway, breathing, and circulation. Is that
that's
right?
Correct. Okay.
And if you could go to page 23. Can you please describe to the jury then what you train officers to do based on this slide within Exhibit 111?
Certainly. After you've determined their level of responsiveness, if they're unresponsive, you're going to first address their airway, and that means just putting them in the most ideal physical position where their airway can be as most in line as possible.
And then what's the next step?
Tilting up the head slightly to open up their... whether you use a head tilt, chin lift, or a jaw thrust maneuver to open up their airway. Okay. And then the next step beyond that is moving into checking for breathing. And if you don't see chest rise, it's just a matter of putting a hand on the center of the chest and, you know, seeing if there's any kind of air moving up and down.
Right. And then what's the next step?
The last is circulation. Yeah. So that's where we're going to be checking a carotid pulse right up here underneath the jaw.
Are there other places that officers are trained that they can use to check for a pulse aside from the carotid?
Yep, absolutely. You can, you know, use your radial here at your wrist. There's multiple points on your body where you can check them, but this is by far and away the most important.
And what are officers trained to do if they are unable to find a pulse?
If you don't have a pulse on a person, you'll immediately start CPR.
Now, I want to go back to the concept of checking for breathing. You indicated that you can look for the chest rising and falling. Is that right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
All right. Do you train officers that, as part of your training, do you train officers that if a person can talk, that means that they can breathe?
No, sir.
Okay. Why not?
Well, that would be incomplete to say, because there is a possibility that somebody could be in respiratory distress and still being able to verbalize it. Just because they're speaking doesn't mean they're breathing adequately.
All right. And getting back to circulation, you indicated that if the officer cannot find a pulse, they're to start CPR. Is that
yes,
correct?
Sir.
And describe what is done to start CPR.
So to start CPR, if you're going to be starting that, if you haven't already contacted EMS to get them en route, you would do that immediately. Then it's a matter of just interlocking your fingers, and you go to the center of the chest, and then you push down about a third of the depth on that person at the rate of about 100 beats per minute.
And is this something, that, again, getting back to the MPD policy, that the officer is trained that they're required to do while they're waiting for the ambulance?
Yes.
And when is the officer supposed to stop CPR?
When you've been relieved by somebody with a higher level of training than you, or if maybe if there was some obvious signs of death, or if you're just, if you've been doing it for a while, if you're absolutely just physically exhausted from doing CPR.
If you could display page 27 of the exhibit. Right. And officers are specifically trained on this, is that right?
Correct.
It can be when the subject becomes responsive or wakes up.
Right.
Or someone else takes over. Or as you stated, it's not safe or you physically can't do it anymore. Is that
correct?
Right?
Yes.
Okay. And is this consistent then with the training that you provide every year to each and every law enforcement officer who is recorded as having taken this training during in-service?
Yes.
I have nothing further. Thank you, Your Honor.
Mr. Nelson. You may. You in.
Sorry about that. Thank you, Your Honor. Sorry about that, ma'am.
No worries.
My glasses. All right, I think I'm ready now. Thank you for joining us today. Just a few follow-up questions. You have been with the Minneapolis Police Department for about 6 years at this point?
Correct.
And prior to that, you said you were an EMT as well, right?
Correct.
Now, as far as the Minneapolis Police Department is concerned, officers are trained as essentially first responders, correct?
Correct, with the EMR certification.
Right, emergency...
medical responder.
And so it's sort of it's a lower level of medical training, correct?
Than an EMT, that is correct.
Right. So you may go to a CPR class, then you have your first responder, and then an EMT paramedic, correct?
That would be a natural progression, yeah.
Right. And so you have experience, did you work as an EMT as well as...
I did.
Okay. And so you have experience both as a police officer as well as an EMT, correct?
Correct.
Now, you testified that part of your role now as running the medical program is to present officers with information as to multiple medical issues that they may encounter.
Correct.
It's not just limited to first aid or first responder, you know, CPR type stuff, correct?
No, we also teach like wellness classes, whether it's sleep, nutrition. We have a wide variety of classes.
Okay. And you have classes on topics including excited delirium?
Correct.
And you have topics including the administration of Narcan?
Correct.
And officers, are all Minneapolis police officers permitted to carry Narcan, assuming they've had the training?
Yes.
And do all Minneapolis police officers receive that training?
Yes.
And so some of these medical topics at these continuing education classes, they may come up an hour here or a half hour there during an in-service, right?
Depends on the topic, yes.
Right. So the EMR stuff is kind of a standalone class. There may be that's a longer class, right?
Correct. That's basically your initial medical training, as you know, you're required to get as your post-certification. That's about a 40-hour class.
Okay. And then you'll have refresher classes on that stuff as well, correct?
It'll contain many of the same topics, but the Minneapolis Police Department doesn't require officers to keep their EMR certification.
Okay. All right. And so the certification that we saw Mr. Chauvin had expiring in 2016, I believe?
That was CPR.
The CPR.
Yep.
And are officers required to then have CPR every 2 years after that?
Yeah, we do CPR classes on a rotating basis, so every other year they go through CPR.
All right. Now, I would like to talk to you about a couple of the Minneapolis policies, if we could. There's essentially two Minneapolis police policies that deal with emergency medical response, correct?
Correct.
One being after a use of force, correct?
That is correct.
And that being as soon as reasonably practical, determine if anyone was injured and render medical aid consistent with training and request EMS if necessary, correct?
Correct.
That's policy 5-306 involving a use of force, correct?
Yes, sir.
And so the policy is somewhat qualified, correct? Meaning it's as soon as reasonably practical, correct?
Correct.
So in the course of the medical training, one of the things that you train officers to do in the administration of first aid is to consider other circumstances, right?
Correct. So you'd have to make sure that your scene is safe before you're able to render aid.
Right. And there's the scene being safe could be not being safe could be come from a number of factors, correct?
Absolutely.
Environmental factors such as where you're located, right?
Yes.
Whether there's a lot of traffic, correct?
Yes.
Or whether there's a lot of bystanders, correct?
Correct.
Depending on their behavior, right?
Yes.
Okay. So scene safety is important, and in fact Minneapolis police or the EMTs won't come to a scene until it's declared code 4 generally, correct?
Generally, yes.
And so oftentimes it's not uncommon for EMTs to stage off-site until police call a scene code 4, correct?
Correct.
Code 4 being all clear, all safe, come on in.
Yes.
And so in that situation, if a scene is unsafe, EMTs don't come in at that point.
Correct.
Right? The other policy that we deal with here. Too many things open here. Is policy, Minneapolis Police Policy 7-350. That's in front of you right now?
It is.
And again, instant or relative to the emergency medical response, Minneapolis police officers are required to request EMS as soon as practical. Correct?
Correct.
And so there may be certain things that prevent an officer from calling in EMS, right?
Absolutely.
So both of the medical policies are somewhat qualified or contingent upon what's going on at the scene at the time, right?
Yes.
Now, in terms of, I believe it was this, Exhibit 111, which is the CPR presentation that you've presented, turn to Bates 21856 down at the bottom there. There is a reference to agonal breathing.
Yes.
What is agonal breathing?
Agonal breathing is something you'll see in somebody who's unresponsive and they're in some sort of respiratory distress. We see this quite often with opiate overdoses, medical emergencies, drownings, what have you.
And can you describe what exactly agonal breathing is?
Well, by name, it's kind of a bad term for it because it's not effective breathing. It's more of less kind of an irregular gasp for air.
Okay.
It's really just kind of like your brain's last ditch effort to try to pull some air in.
And a person observing someone going through agonal breathing, it's common or it would be possible that they would misinterpret that as actual breathing, effective breathing.
Yes, it can be easily confused with real breathing, so that's why we teach. This is not effective breathing.
Right. So an officer is dealing with someone who's experiencing agonal breathing. It would potentially be possible for an officer to misinterpret agonal breathing for effective breathing.
It could.
And in certain circumstances where there's a lot of noise or a lot of commotion, would it be more likely that that could happen?
Yes.
Now, you were shown this slide in terms of when do we stop CPR. And one of the reasons you stop performing CPR is because it's not safe, right?
Correct.
And by it being not safe, are you referring to the process of actually giving CPR or the environment that you would be doing it in?
It would be the environment around you. That would be reasonable, yes.
Okay. Now, you also testified that you teach on Narcan and the use of Narcan.
Correct.
And I am going to show you. You can see this training in front of you?
Yes.
Is this training that you provide to Minneapolis police officers?
Yes.
And this is the this is the program on, like, the broader course on how to administer Narcan, correct?
Correct.
And do you recognize this as a record that you keep in the ordinary course of your business?
Yes, sir.
This, Mr. Slisher, I had labeled as Exhibit 1041. And I would move to admit Exhibit 1041.
No objection.
1041 is received.
And permission to publish 1041. This is from the Minneapolis Police Department in service from July of 2018.
Correct.
And if Mr. Chauvin had attended this program and or his in-service in July or through September of 2018, he would have received this training, correct?
Correct.
Now, in recent years, fentanyl has become more of a concern for officers to be aware of, correct?
Absolutely.
And ultimately, you train officers in the use of Narcan to contraindicate, or to contradict, I should say, the effects of Narcan, right?
Oh, excuse me, opiates, yes.
Including fentanyl.
Correct.
Right? Now, in your experience as a police officer and as a medical trainer, have you experienced individuals who take combinations of drugs?
Yes.
Have you heard the term speedball?
I have.
And would you agree that that is generally the combination of both a stimulant like methamphetamine and a depressant like fentanyl?
Yes.
Objection, cyber, Your
Can you describe for the jury what a speedball is?
It's essentially a combination of an upper and a downer.
And has that become commonplace in your experience?
Yes.
Now, as fentanyl has become more prominent, do you see that in legal forms, such as patches or other pills that may be administered by a hospital?
Objection, leading.
Do you see that on the streets?
Yes, you'll see totally legitimate pharmaceutical purposes, and then also illicit, you know, drugs that were manufactured outside of lines.
Can you explain for the jury whether, in your experience, you've seen illicit fentanyl use on the rise?
Yes, becoming absolutely.
And I'm going to just show you, generally when you talk about someone, you show it to officers in this training, when someone is on the experiencing an opiate overdose, you may see this type of behavior. Is that correct?
You could, yes.
Someone may fall asleep, someone may be very tired, kind of out of it, right?
Correct.
Let's get back to the right question.
Sorry. Would this be consistent with what you would see generally on a opiate overdose?
It could be.
Have you ever been at a scene where an opiate overdose, someone can be more responsive?
Yes.
Even though they've taken an opiate?
Correct.
Now, in terms of fentanyl, can you explain this slide?
Certainly. So this is a diagram to show you just what could be considered a lethal dose of fentanyl. Just, it's more of a visual indicator, because we already know how dangerous heroin is, and you can see a trace amount of that could be deadly with fentanyl, and even more so with carfentanyl.
And so even fentanyl, even in very small doses, can be fatal. Would that be accurate?
Objection, Your Honor. Sidebar.
I'll rephrase the question.
Mm-hmm.
persist in the objection, Your Honor.
All right, Lou, so they're talking a lot about the drugs here.
Yeah, so Eric Nelson is obviously trying to bring up ways to show the jury that when somebody has an overdose from fentanyl, for example, that it wouldn't present itself the way that the prosecution has already told the jury during opening statements that it would. And so in this last slide, he was also showing how much fentanyl, how little fentanyl can be deadly, how it just takes a very small amount to be deadly.
For a fatal overdose. And yeah. We already know from what we've heard in testimony so far that George Floyd did have a large amount of fentanyl in his system.
Yes, he definitely did. However, the prosecution made a point through his girlfriend's testimony to establish that he has a tolerance because he's been taking it and surviving, obviously, day after day leading up to this.
Right. What started as a pain issue with prescription drugs then led to an addiction.
Yes. And so Eric Nelson, obviously, is trying to, for the defense, bring it back to, you know, that it doesn't take much fentanyl to be an overdose. And when he talks about, he also was talking about a speedball, which what that means is a mixture of meth and fentanyl, or an upper and a downer, and that what he had said earlier through other witnesses is that the effects of that are different than somebody who has taken just fentanyl, for example.
And so just trying to get into the jury's mind that the drugs are a part of this in his for the defense.
Yeah, absolutely. He's just taking advantage of the expertise of the witness who's up there right now to try to get in a little bit of reasonable doubt using the expertise that this witness has. And she's
who's there
the
on behalf of the state at this. Like, we need to remind people that everyone who's up on the stand right now.
She's the state's witness to talk about the training that officers receive in providing medical care. She's the one that trains them how to use Narcan, for example. And she showed a couple slides to offer proof that Derek Chauvin was trained in CPR. And so the prosecution's using that to show that Derek Chauvin should have started CPR on George Floyd when he became motionless because he's trained to do so. But then here's the other side of the coin. During cross-examination, Eric Nelson is able to get in this other stuff that helps his side of the case as well.
Always good to remember that no matter who you bring up to the stand, that the other side has an opportunity to make to benefit from it as well.
Yeah, for sure. And then after that, the prosecution will do their redirect where they try to rehabilitate the witness to bring back to recoup some of the losses here in cross-examination.
All right, I think they're coming back. Let's head back into court.
So these are the training materials that you present to Minneapolis police officers relevant to the use of Narcan and controlled substances that they may encounter while in their performance of their duties, correct?
Correct.
All right. Now, in terms of, and we can take this down, in terms of just again, general training, you'd already said that you also discuss with officers the concepts of excited delirium, correct?
Correct.
And you provide them with training and materials about what that means, correct?
Yes.
All right. And generally speaking, without reviewing to your training materials, can you describe what you train Minneapolis police officers about excited delirium?
Certainly. This is a class that is taught at the academy. It's a one hour block of instruction to recognize the signs and symptoms of excited delirium and your best responses for handling that. So excited delirium, it's a combination of psychomotor agitation, psychosis, hypothermia, a wide variety of things you might see in a person or rather bizarre behavior. And recognizing that this is a medical condition, not necessarily a criminal matter.
Would that include discussion of controlled substances in the context of excited delirium?
Yes, because what we're usually teaching is that most of the people that are experiencing something like excited delirium, usually there's illicit drugs on board that might be a contributing factor.
And as far as What do you train Minneapolis police officers relevant to the physical attributes of a person experiencing excited delirium?
The person might be experiencing a hyperthermia, very means elevated body temperature. That could be displayed with, you know, somebody taking off their clothes in a place that's not appropriate to take off your clothes, or in like middle of winter or something like that. Just based on their activity, their heart rate might be extremely elevated, and they might be insensitive to pain.
How does it affect strength?
Because you don't really have that pain compliance that would normally otherwise kind of control somebody's behavior. So somebody experiencing this, they might have what we call superhuman strength. They might be able to lift things they wouldn't normally otherwise be able to lift. They might be breaking things where they then have blood-like substances that you need to be cautious of.
Thank you. Now, in terms of, I'm going to just back up and talk a little bit more about the response to a medical emergency by EMS, again, based on your experience as a police officer and an EMT. You talked about how sometimes EMS will stage off site until a scene is clear and safe, correct?
Correct.
And have you heard the term load and go?
Yes.
Can you describe for the jury what that is?
Load and go, I think it's more like an informal term that's used with first responders. That essentially means that as soon as they're going to be arriving, it's a priority to get that person into the ambulance as soon as possible and get en route to the hospital as soon as possible.
Are there reasons why an EMT would, or a paramedic would, choose to do that rather than administering first aid at the scene?
Yes.
What are those reasons?
If you don't know, just say so.
Sure. I feel comfortable answering it. And by way of example, if maybe somebody had a knife in their chest, obviously, I mean, there's only so many things you can do for that person pre-hospital. Really, the only thing that's going to save that person is immediate surgery.
Sure. So there may be conditions of the individual that warrant that type of pick up and go?
Yeah.
And what about people in the area? Could that affect an EMT's decision to load and go?
Yes.
How so?
If you had a very hostile or volatile crowd, I know it sounds unreasonable, but bystanders do occasionally attack EMS crews. So sometimes just getting out of the situation is kind of the best way to defuse it.
Okay. And have you ever had to perform emergency services in not even a hostile crowd, just a loud, excited crowd?
Yes.
Is that, in your experience, more or less difficult?
It's incredibly difficult.
Why?
Because if you're trying to be heads down on a patient that you need to render aid to, it's very difficult to focus on that patient while there's other things around you. If you don't feel safe around you, if you don't have enough resources, it's very difficult to focus on the one thing in front of you.
It can be distracting.
Absolutely.
And so does it make it more difficult to assess a patient?
It does.
Does it make it more likely that you may miss signs that a patient is experiencing something?
Yes.
And so the distraction can actually harm the potential care of the patient.
Yes.
Okay. I have no further questions.
Thank
you. Are officers trained that sometimes they have to provide emergency medical services in less than ideal conditions?
Yes.
The rendering of emergency aid in practice does not happen in a classroom setting, does it?
Correct.
Right, and so you're in the environment as you find it, is that right?
Yes.
And in terms of a crowd being hostile, how would you define hostility?
That would be a growing contingent of people around if they're, yelling, being, even verbally abusive to those that are trying to provide scene security.
Okay. What else?
If there's people trying to interfere with a crime scene or, interfere with a patient. Absolutely.
Perhaps use a weapon.
Yep.
Throw rocks or bottles.
Yes.
Something like that could prevent someone from providing emergency aid. Is that right?
Absolutely.
Can the activities, though, of a crowd, the activities of a group of onlookers excuse a police officer from the duty to render emergency medical aid to a subject who needs it?
Only if they were physically getting themselves involved, I would say.
If they were physically prevented, if the officer was physically prevented from doing it.
Yes, if the officer is being physically assaulted.
I wanted to talk a little bit about some of the things you said were indicative of excited delirium. You said superhuman strength, is that right?
Yes.
And I think what you said was that it was because of the inability to feel pain, is that right?
That's a part of it, yes.
And the inability to feel pain is something that you associate with, or you train officers to associate with excited delirium?
That it could be a case of excited delirium, yes.
And so if someone was actually manifesting a response to pain, indicating that something was hurting them, then that would tend to indicate that they're not suffering from excited delirium. Isn't that right?
Rephrase.
What would a subject's response to pain stimulus suggest then, as it relates to excited delirium?
That, well, it may or may not be excited delirium. It's a little bit hard to predict because no two people ever really present the exact same way.
So then how do you tell what it is?
Well, that's not up for us to diagnose. It's just a matter of taking in the information you have at that time to decide if this could potentially be a case of that, or you just need to plan accordingly.
And you indicated that whatever excited delirium is, you'd look at it as a medical issue.
Correct.
That needs treatment.
Yes.
And in terms of drug use as well, it's fair to say that if someone is showing indicia of drug intoxication, it can make them vulnerable.
Yes.
Not just violent.
Correct. Right.
Thank you. Nothing further.
Members of the jury, let's take 10 minutes. We have to deal with one issue. A witness will remain, however. So 10 minutes and we'll be back in touch.
All right, Lou, taking a quick break there. We just had the one witness since the lunch break today, and obviously talking a little bit about the training that Derek Chauvin would have received mm-hmm. as far as CPR and first aid is concerned.
Yeah, she is in charge to a certain extent of medical training at MPD. And if we need to go back to the court here, I'm not sure if any sound is coming from the courts, but let us know in the back room there. Mm-hmm. Okay, so yeah, there was a point to her testimony from the state's perspective, and I believe that was to show that Derek Chauvin would be, we're going to go back to court here for a minute.
The hearing of the jury, but on the record, there was a sidebar at some point where the state objected to the excited delirium training material, and essentially, I think, Mr. Slisher, I don't want to speak for you too much, that your preference would be that Mr. Nelson not be allowed to present it at this time, but only as part of his case in chief, which would require this witness to come back during his case in chief. Is that correct?
It is, sir.
All right, and so that's the basic objection, is the timing as opposed to the admissibility.
Yes, sir.
Okay, Mr. Nelson, what did you want to deal with?
If we could have a private conversation.
All right.
Go ahead, Lou.
So Rena, it appears that this 10-minute break is just a 10-minute break for the jury, not necessarily for what's going on in the courtroom.
Okay.
So we should be ready to go back as soon as it seems like this sidebar is coming to an end here. But this stuff about excited delirium is something that the prosecution wanted to keep out as much as they could from this trial, because in medical circles, it's not looked at with as much credibility
right.
as it is in police circles. Police officers are trained on it, but as that ER doctor testified yesterday morning, he said he called it controversial. So this idea is already out there with the jury, that excited delirium, this concept that somebody could come up with superhuman strength or come back to life, is seen as controversial medically, but it's something that police are trained on. And so it's a little confusing as far as the relevance in this trial.
All right, let's go hear what he has to say.
I'm going to excuse you for the day. She can be excused at this point, is that correct?
Yes.
You can be excused for the day, but the defense would like to call you back during their case. And so Mr. Nelson will serve a subpoena on you at some point so that you've got it mostly for his contact information.
Sure.
Because in the interim, I'm going to order that your subpoena that you were previously served still is in force, and that you should, unless you're here otherwise, come next Tuesday at 9 a.m. But most likely, Mr. Nelson will be in contact to tell you when exactly, so you don't just waste your time coming down here.
Yes, sir.
Does that work?
Understood. Yep.
Okay. So, Mr. Nelson, how is that going to be served?
Department?
Normally, yes.
So I can just serve the police through the normal or through the Federation or something?
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. We'll make sure that gets done. But for today, you're excused.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you.
All right. We'll be in recess until 2:35 at least, if not 22.
Okay, Lou, so we're officially taking a little break here, mm-hmm. an afternoon break here. And the interesting thing that just kind of developed there was that the state obviously brought this witness in. They don't want, as we were just talking about, the defense to be able to bring up this excited delirium. So it sounds like it's more of just a hoop jumping. They're trying to make the defense jump through some hoops in order to get her back in again.
And part of it is perception as well. I think that if excited delirium comes up while she's the state witness, mm-hmm. and it seems to help the defense, then that weighs differently on the jury than if Eric Nelson called her as a witness later on.
Right.
But the excited delirium is part of it, that the prosecution wants as little of that as possible, and the defense wants as much of it as possible, as the defense is just trying to come up, with some reasonable doubt as to, the charges and each element of the charges.
Absolutely. And we have some guests that are able to join us to go over a little bit of what we've been hearing from this particular witness. Mm-hmm. Do you want to bring your guest in now?
Yeah, I believe we have Tom Heffelfinger. He is a former U.S. attorney, currently in private practice, decades of experience. Tom, first, give us your thoughts on the testimony that we just heard from the first witness of the afternoon.
First of all, they're trying to establish from the prosecution perspective that Chauvin was trained to provide emergency medical care in response to somebody who was in distress, as George Floyd clearly was. This appears to actually, in my thinking, tend to support the third charge against Mr. Chauvin, which is that negligence theory. The part of it is that you were trained to help people who were in distress and you didn't. Therefore, you're negligent for not having done that, and you were trained to do so. They've got to prove every one of the three counts. That one in particular seems to fit well with the failure to provide aid. The other part about the narcotics, and she's, because she's the Narcan supervisor, she's a good person to focus on fentanyl, its dangers, how much is on the street, etc. All of that actually, in my opinion, helps the defense. It's almost as if in this case, the fact that George Floyd was had a large amount of very serious narcotics in his system at the time of his death is almost an undebated issue. So the more conversation we have about narcotics and narcotic use by George Floyd, the more that goes, in my opinion, to the defense focus on the fact that this man was died from an overdose.
Okay, you brought up a couple good points there, Tom. First of all, and I guess it's important to remind people, like, they're not saying, okay, now we're going to tell you all the evidence for manslaughter, and then now we're going to tell you all the evidence for murder. They kind of do sprinkle this stuff throughout. And so from with that in mind, does it seem like this the reason that the state would call this witness was to get in this negligence evidence so that during closing arguments they can circle back and talk about negligence, and that's why they should find him guilty of manslaughter?
That's one of the reasons. All of the evidence that goes to the failure to provide effective medical care on the street at the time all goes to all three of the charges, but it seems most probative as to the negligence charge. And yes, they don't do it in, they don't offer the evidence in little compartments. They offer it, and then they, in final argument, that's where you use the time to point out the evidence of negligence.
Okay. Well, let's take a quick lesson back on some of the cross-examination that we just heard.
What would a subject's response to pain stimulus suggest then as it relates to excited delirium?
That, well, it may or may not be excited delirium. It's a little bit hard to predict because no two people ever really present the exact same way.
So then how do you tell what it is?
Well, that's not up for us to diagnose. It's just a matter of taking in the information you have at that time to decide if this could potentially be a case of that, or you just need to plan accordingly.
And you indicated that whatever excited delirium is, you'd look at it as a medical issue.
Correct.
That needs treatment.
Yes.
And in terms of drug use as well, it's fair to say that if someone is showing indicia of drug intoxication, it can make them vulnerable.
Yes.
Not just violent.
Correct.
Sure. So there may be conditions of the individual that warrant that type of pick up and go?
Yeah.
And what about people in the area? Could that affect an EMT's decision to load and go?
Yes.
How so?
If you had a very hostile or volatile crowd, I know it sounds unreasonable, but bystanders do occasionally attack EMS crews. So sometimes just getting out of the situation is kind of the best way to defuse it.
Okay. And have you ever had to perform emergency services in not even a hostile crowd, just a loud, excited crowd?
Yes.
Is that, in your experience, more or less difficult?
It's incredibly difficult.
And so there we heard Eric Nelson was able to somehow get in there, a response to crowds being hostile, and that being one reason why EMS crews take off as soon as they pick up. And then also what we heard there was the prosecution having to address this idea of excited delirium on redirect. Tom, your thoughts on that?
Well, as I recall, Eric's also the one who got this witness to say that when it's a code 4, the EMSs will arrive, and they only show up when it's a code 4. Well, in this case, they showed up because it was a code 4. So the officers on the scene recognized that it was safe enough to have the EMTs come in for care. But they're going back and forth. The defense has consistently, with almost every law enforcement witness, attempted to establish that crowds can be violent. But again, remember, this is a long trial. There's a lot of witnesses, and these witnesses have all testified about the same 9 or 10 minute period of time. And the jury is going to be the ones to decide whether that 9-year-old little girl and the Mr. Williams, the mixed martial artist, whether they presented a threat to the police. You also got to remember, you had an officer standing there whose only job was to keep the crowd back, and appears to have done it successfully.
Tom, a couple of things here. At one point, the state objected to the line of questioning that Mr. Nelson was giving to this particular witness. And then the judge said to her, well, if you feel comfortable. And she said, you know, I feel comfortable answering. I'm sure at that point, the state was like, please stop talking. But do you feel like that was there a lot of damage done by what she had to say afterwards?
No, in my recollection, it had to do with familiarity with medical conditions and medical treatment. And You forget this is a lady who trains on emergency medical response. She's also an EMT. And so when they ask her a question that goes to sort of a medical response like an EMT would get, she's perfectly qualified to answer it, and you get what you ask for.
And with the crowd, you mentioned that a couple of times, as does the defense keep mentioning the crowd or trying to get these witnesses to talk about how a police officer's job would be more difficult or rendering aid would be more difficult if a crowd was angry or coming at you or prepared to attack. Why isn't the state doing more to show that, like you said, there was a nine-year-old girl standing on the sidewalk there? So why aren't they hammering that point home more?
Rena, if they had, the judge would probably sustain an objection that it's cumulative. Mm-hmm. In other words, you're saying the same thing multiple times. They spent the first 2 to 3 days of this trial offering testimony from the people on the street corner, and they're the ones who were able to testify they weren't dangerous.
All right, Tom, I believe court is coming back into session here, so we're going to head back into the courtroom now. Thank you. We'll check back with you later.
Another short break. It probably won't be our full 20, but just if you're wondering, are we going to be pushing through? No. We all need to stay well. And so we're going to take another break eventually this afternoon. Mr. Slisher, you may call your next witness.
Thank you, Your Honor. The state calls Jody Steiger.
Stand right here.
Yes, sir.
Raise your hand. Do you swear or affirm under penalty of perjury that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
Have a seat.
Can I hear? No.
And if you wouldn't mind, if you would use this to grab that stylus that's there and give it to me. All right. Thank you. And we're going to swap it out with that. And I'd ask that you, remove your mask if you feel comfortable doing so.
Yes, sir.
And let's begin by having you state your full name, spelling each of your names.
Yes, sir. Jody Steiger, J-O-D-Y-S-T-I-G-E-R.
Mr. Slisher.
Thank you, Your Honor. Sir, how are you employed?
I'm employed with the Los Angeles Police Department.
In what capacity?
I'm a sergeant.
And you understand that you're here today serving as a retained expert for the state in this matter, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
So this is outside your typical duties as a sergeant with the LA Police Department, correct?
Yes, sir, I'm on vacation.
All right. Well, welcome to Minnesota.
Thank you.
Sir, before we begin your testimony, I'd like you to just introduce yourself and share a little bit about your background with the jury. First, how old are you?
I'm 50 years old.
Okay. And you indicated that you're currently a sergeant with the LAPD. Can you please describe for the jury how you came to be involved in law enforcement?
Yes. So shortly after leaving the Marine Corps, I joined the Los Angeles Police Department in April of 1993. Yesterday was my 28-year anniversary. Did the police academy. After graduating the police academy, I was assigned to a patrol division, and from there, I was recruited to work undercover in the high schools to buy drugs.
Los Angeles high schools?
Yes.
Okay, and you were working as an undercover?
Yes.
How long did you have that assignment?
Approximately 6 months.
Okay. What did you do after that?
After that, I was assigned to another patrol division in South Los Angeles, Southwest Division, near the campus of University of Southern California. And I worked there until 1998.
All right. And what were your duties just generally on as a patrol officer in that particular area of Los Angeles?
For the first 2 years of patrol, was just handling calls for service primarily. During that time, it was a pretty violent time in Los Angeles. I believe the, on average, in our division, we averaged anywhere from 100 to 200 homicides a year. So it was a pretty dangerous area.
Okay. And after then, you said you held that position as a patrol officer for how many years?
Just for patrol specifically, I was there for 2 years, and then I was recruited to work the gang unit at the same division.
In the same geographic area?
Yes.
Describe that work for the jury.
It was primarily gang intelligence. I was assigned a specific gang and neighborhood, and our assignment was to gather intelligence, make arrests, and handle any calls of service that were specific to that specific gang.
How long did you work in the gang unit?
In that specific gang unit for 3.5 years.
And where did you go after that?
I was recruited to go and work at FBI task force in the same bureau for specific to that gang that I was assigned to in Southwest Division.
And was that a more of a long-term investigation?
Yes. So we were doing investigative work, and so basically we handled all crimes other than murders and sexual assaults that were committed by that specific gang.
Right. And how long did you do that?
I did that for approximately a year and a half.
Then where did you go?
Then I was recruited, and I was assigned to the training division at our for in-service tactics.
And approximately what year was that?
Approximately 2000.
And what did you do for your in-service tactics unit?
For the in-service tactics unit, we developed a 32-hour course. It was the first of its kind for the Los Angeles Police Department. It was a 4-day course where we went over de-escalation, firearms manipulation, basic patrol tactics, and arrest control techniques.
Okay. And what was your assignment afterwards?
After that position, I was promoted to sergeant.
And you spent some time on the use of force board for your department?
Yes, as a peer member.
What does that mean?
So the way the Los Angeles Police Department's use of force review is set up is there's three stages. So you have initially you have a use for, these are for the higher profile uses of force, not all uses of force. The higher level uses of force. So you have a use of force review board that convenes, and there's four command staff and one peer member. So depending on the officer involved, if it's a police officer, then you have a peer that's an officer. If it's a sergeant, detective, so on and so forth. And so I was a peer member from 2003 until 2007. So I was a peer member as a police officer as well as a sergeant, where I sat on the board as a board of five people, four command staff and the peer, and basically we review all the information that was gathered during the investigation, and we make recommendations to the chief of police. At that point, the chief of police then gets that information. He makes a recommendation to the police commission, and then the police commission has the final say.
And what you're reviewing is actions, conduct involving uses of force of other officers, is that right?
Yes, sir.
And then what was your next assignment after serving on that board?
That was just an adjunct duty, so I was called as needed. As I stated earlier, I was promoted to sergeant. In 2006, and I was assigned to our Central Division, which is downtown Los Angeles.
Okay. What was required to become a sergeant for the LAPD?
You have to take a written test, and once you pass the written test, you also have to go through an interview process, and then you're ranked. You also have to have a certain amount of college credits in order to be eligible to take the test.
You were then eventually selected as sergeant. Can you tell the jury what your first duty was as a sergeant?
Yes, my first duty was assigned to our Central Division, which is downtown Los Angeles, in the Skid Row area.
In the Skid Row area?
Yes, sir.
And doing what?
I was a patrol sergeant, a field sergeant.
So describe what that job was like. What were you supposed to do?
General duties of a field sergeant is supervising officers assigned to a specific watch. Normally, anywhere from 10 to 20 officers would be assigned to a specific watch, and you may be one or two supervisors that are assigned to that watch as well, and you have general duties such as providing roll call training in the early beginning of the watch, as well as just overall supervision, making sure that officers are conducting themselves properly, as well as if there's a use of force, you have to respond to the use of force and take the use of force investigations as well.
And did you take a different position after serving as a sergeant?
I'm still a sergeant, but yes, within about 6 months, I was assigned to our Safer Cities initiative, which was focused on the homeless problem in Skid Row area. So I did that for the next year and a half.
Now, you've described a couple of geographic areas of Los Angeles in which you've served as a patrol officer and a patrol sergeant.
Yes.
I'd like you to please just describe in general terms those areas in terms of the dangerousness or the crime rate there.
Well, in my first assignment in South Bureau, South Bureau historically has the highest violent crime in the city. Central Bureau and Central Division usually is second or third.
Right. And what kind of crimes are you typically responding to?
Primarily violent crimes, robberies, assaults, things of that nature.
And I'd also like you to just describe for the jury the training that you received in the use of force and defensive tactics to help you do your job as a patrol officer and a patrol sergeant.
I was unique in a sense because I was a tactics instructor for 6 years. So I had a lot of background in use of force and tactics prior to making sergeant. Prior to that, as a patrol officer, we would get quarterly training as well as annual training that would keep us up to date on any changes in laws or policy and procedures.
And what does it mean to be a tactics instructor?
For our department and for the state of California, you have to go through different types of training. So I've been through our force options instructor training, as well as de-escalation training. I'm a trainer for de-escalation, force options. I've been through the FBI range master course, so I'm a handgun instructor as well, and a number of leadership courses as well.
Okay. And have you had an educational role or a teaching role within your department?
Yes, as I stated earlier, for 6 years I was a tactics instructor for in-service training for the course I mentioned earlier.
So this would in-service training would be for already serving officers, is that right? Experienced officers?
Yes.
And it would be in the form of annual training?
Yes.
Okay. During that annual training, would you provide training as to your department's use of force policy?
Yes, and state law.
And state law. And have you reviewed generally use of force policies and across the nation and compared those with the use of force policies in your department?
Yes. So at my current position, I am the aide to the Inspector General, which is an oversight entity that is within the Los Angeles Police Department, independent of the department itself. I'm the only sworn officer that works for that unit. There's 28 overall employees. During my time there, I was able to travel nationwide and go to a number of different police agencies to basically compare their use of force policies as well as their training with Los Angeles Police Department.
And are your policies in the Los Angeles Police Department fairly consistent with the policies and standards nationwide?
Yes, sir.
Is there sort of a nationwide sort of acceptable reasonableness of a police officer that's generally accepted in your field?
Objection. Overruled.
Yes.
Getting back to your days as a trainer for defensive tactics and instruction, approximately how many Los Angeles police officers did you provide training in that six-year time period?
In the initial six-year time period, approximately 3,000 officers.
And can you explain to the jury the types of training that you provided, the specific topics?
As I stated earlier, the main focus was de-escalation. We taught them basic patrol tactics such as vehicle stops, pedestrian stops, as well as firearms manipulation. And ultimately, we would do at the end of the four-day course, the goal was for them to utilize their de-escalation tactics so they wouldn't have to use force.
Did you teach specific tactics, ground training or anything like that?
No, we taught all the subjects.
Right. Now, you indicated in your current role with the department, you do use of force reviews, is that correct?
No, not in my current role.
In a prior role, I should
yes.
say you did. Okay. In terms of the use for force reviews and the numbers of use of force reviews that you've completed in your career, can you estimate approximately how many you've done?
Approximately 2,500.
And of those 2,500 force reviews, have you ever made findings that the use of force was excessive or objectively unreasonable?
Yes.
And have you ever made findings where such a use of force was not excessive?
Yes.
And when you've done use of force reviews, has that included the review of the use of deadly force?
Yes, in certain situations. Primarily in that role, after being a patrol sergeant, I was promoted and assigned to be a training coordinator for South Bureau, which is pretty much all of South Los Angeles. In that bureau, we had approximately 1,600 officers, and at the time it was four patrol divisions and one traffic division. And so my job was to oversee the training for that bureau.
Are you a member of any professional organizations?
Yes, I'm a member of a few.
Could you name them, please?
Employee organization, the Oscar Joe Bryant Foundation, which represents African-American officers on the police department. I'm a member of I'm drawing a blank, I'm sorry. a number of them, I'm trying to not say the acronyms because then I got to say them all out. But a number of other police organizations that involve tactical managers.
And have you been called upon by other law enforcement agencies to provide instruction in the use of force?
Instructions specifically, no. I've consulted with a number of other agencies.
Consultation of use of force reviews?
Yes.
Okay. What other agencies have you assisted?
I've assisted the University of California, Office of the President. I've assisted King County Office of the Ombudsman. I've assisted California City Police Department, as well as the University of California Irvine Police Department.
Did you, you have indicated already that you've been retained as an expert witness for the state in this matter, is that right?
Yes, sir.
And you've conducted then a review of some of the various materials associated with the death of George Floyd that happened on May 25, 2020, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Do you charge a fee for your services?
Yes.
And can you please tell the jury what the fee is in this matter?
There was a flat fee of $10,000, and for trial, the fee is $2,950.
And that has included reviewing all of the different offense materials that you were provided, is that right?
Yes, sir.
And could you please tell the jury, just in general, high-level terms, what offense materials you have reviewed?
I reviewed all the body-worn videos, all the other videos that were provided to me that were cell phone videos, poll videos, things of that nature, reports, manuals from the Minneapolis Police Department, as well as the training materials.
One moment, if we may have a sidebar, Your Honor.
All right, Lou, so they are sidebarring after just hearing about this witness obviously being paid to be there today.
Okay, so a quick sidebar today. This witness here, Jody Steiger, is from the Los Angeles Police Department, and he is one of the state's national use of force experts. And so prior to the trial, they had to give like his full credentials and everything. The defense knows what he's going to testify about. It sounded like they were about to go back.
It did.
Here we are.
All right, based upon your review of the different materials that you have conducted in this case, and based upon your own experience and training in law enforcement, have you reached an opinion as to the degree and amount of force used by the defendant, Mr. Chauvin, on George Floyd?
Yes.
Okay. And can I ask you to explain to the jury a little bit about what process or methodology you go through to render such an opinion?
There's a few steps. The main step is going through the objective reasonableness standard, which is based off of Graham versus Connor. Looking at the seriousness of the crime, looking at the person's actions, things of that nature, as well as looking at the specific agency's policies and procedures as well.
Okay. In addition to the seriousness of the crime under the Graham standard, do you look at any other factors?
I try to look at a number of factors. What was known to the officers at the time? And again, like I stated, one of the biggest things I look at is what was the person's actions at the time that the officer was using force.
All right. And based upon your review of these materials and in light of the Graham factors, what is your opinion as to the degree of force used by the defendant on Mr. Floyd on the date in question?
My opinion was that the force was excessive.
Before we then talk about that, the specific basis for that, we need to define a few terms. And what is force?
Force could be typically what officers would use in a law enforcement perspective. Obviously, force is different techniques and tools that officers may use to try to take someone into custody or apprehend the person or to control them.
Can force include a restraint?
Yes.
If I may show you Exhibit 17, which has been received into evidence. All right. Can you describe what it is you see here?
I see a officer with his knee on the neck of Mr. Floyd.
Is this a form of force?
Yes.
Okay. Now, and you can remove Exhibit 17. Oh, I'm sorry. That was supposed to be published.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's all right. If you could republish the exhibit then, 17. This is specifically what we're talking about in terms of the force you were reviewing, is that right?
Yes, sir.
And the force that you stated in your opinion was excessive, is that the force that began right around the point that Mr. Floyd was on the ground?
Yes, sir.
All right. Now, I'd like to then focus your attention to the Graham versus Connor factors. You indicated that one of the factors that you consider is the severity of the offense being investigated. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
And do you recall what was the severity of the offense being investigated here?
If I remember correctly, it was Mr. Floyd was accused of having a counterfeit $20 bill.
And how does that particular offense or the severity of the offense relate to the appropriateness of the force to be used against him?
Typically, in a normal situation where you're dealing with someone that's a counterfeiter or someone who is using a counterfeit bill, typically you wouldn't even expect to use any type of force.
When you're looking at, in the Connor standard, the severity of the offense, is the label of the offense, be it a misdemeanor or felony, is that important?
In some cases, yes.
What do you find more important than the label of the offense?
The person's actions.
And so would it be fair to describe the counterfeit $20 bill as a fairly low-level offense?
Yes.
And in the Connor world, then, that would justify lesser force. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Then the second factor is whether the person would pose some sort of an immediate threat. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Can you describe to the jury what is a threat?
A threat can be perceived as something where an officer feels that the person is going to assault them or going to assault someone else.
And is identifying a level of threat, is that an objective standard, a subjective standard? How is that viewed?
It could be subjective.
Okay. How so?
Depending on the officer, their training and experience.
Okay. And when we talk about threat, I'd like you to distinguish between a threat and a risk. Is there a difference between a threat and a risk?
Yes.
Explain that difference to the jury.
So typically, as police officers, anytime we go into a situation, there's a risk factor involved just based on the nature of policing. It's kind of, I try to describe it as when I'm teaching, I describe it as if you're going into the middle of a movie and you don't know what's going on, so you're trying to figure out all the information as you're going through. As far as a threat is concerned, a threat would be once someone becomes combative or assaultive towards you or towards another person.
Now, what kind of factors can present a risk?
The location, just the mere call itself, the call for service, what the actual crime was.
What about the characteristics of the subject? What characteristics of the subject can pose a potential risk?
I'm sorry, could you?
For example, the size of the subject.
Yes, in certain instances, size and stature do make a difference.
Okay. In terms of a risk, is that right?
Yes.
Is the size of a subject, would a large subject necessarily constitute a threat?
No, not necessarily.
And why is that?
Again, it's based on the person's actions, not specifically just their size and stature.
And so in conducting a use of force review or looking at the objective reasonableness of force, is it appropriate to use force against an individual simply because of their larger size?
No.
And I'd like you to discuss the Connor standard of resistance, whether the person is resisting or attempting to evade law enforcement officers. Is that something you review?
Yes.
Okay. And were you able to make any kind of assessment in this case as to whether or not Mr. Floyd was offering resistance or trying to evade law enforcement officers?
Yes.
Okay. And what was your assessment?
Initially, when Mr. Floyd was being placed in the back seat of the vehicle, he was actively resisting the officers. So at that point, the officers were justified in utilizing force to try to have him comply with their commands and to seat him in the back seat of the vehicle. However, once he was placed in the prone position on the ground, he slowly ceased his resistance, and at that point, the officers, ex-officers, I should say, they should have slowed down or stopped their force as well.
Okay. Now, I'd like to back up to a certain point, and you indicated.
All right, Lou, we got another sidebar here, obviously right in the middle of questioning of this Sergeant Steiger.
Yeah, Sergeant Steiger is testifying about use of force, and he's talking about the standards that are used. And the standard that's used is that the use of force is reasonable to the officer knowing what they knew at the time. So you can't bring in facts that you learn later
sure.
to Monday morning quarterback it. And he testified that he thought that it was an unreasonable use of force, which is no surprise, obviously. And as you notice, he was talking about, you know, how it could have been handled from the very beginning to a certain extent.
Well, and the one thing that I thought was interesting was that the state brought up the fact that he is paid to be there, something that the defense would have done. So they were trying to get it out of the way.
I've been in trials before where the defense uses that as a kind of like a gotcha question
right.
when they're cross-examining. How much are you paid to be here, sir? You
right.
know, of course, these expert witnesses are all paid. So the defense also pays their expert. Now, I'm sure the prosecution, if Nelson doesn't bring that up first with his own expert, the prosecution would do the same. And so you're right. They were getting ahead of what could have been, you know, a question that is framed in a way that isn't, you know, it means something more than it really does.
And at this point now, this is the first person that we've seen that would be paid, right? This is, we've seen mostly
exactly.
police officers.
Everybody else has been subpoenaed to testify okay. so far. This is the first actual paid expert.
All right, here we go. Back into court.
Could you state the question again?
And so, I asked you to make an assessment as to the reasonability of the force that was used by the law enforcement officers as it relates to whether or not Mr. Floyd was offering any kind of resistance. Is that, you recall that?
Yes, sir.
And I believe you indicated that Mr. Floyd was offering resistance initially outside of the vehicle. Is that right?
Yes, outside and inside the vehicle.
Okay. And then, however, there was a time that Mr. Floyd was taken outside of the vehicle and placed on the ground. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
And you indicated at that point, after he was placed on the ground, the officers, what should they have done?
They should have de-escalated the situation or attempted to. Okay.
And what did they do instead, based on your review?
They continued the force that they were utilizing from the time that they first put him on the ground.
Right. Now, I want to make sure that when we're talking about the evaluation of the use of force, you're evaluating this application of force from what perspective?
First, I look at it from a grand perspective, as well as the Minneapolis Police Department's use of force policy.
And is the standard then the through the view of a reasonable police officer on the scene?
Yes.
And when, since we're talking about the actions specifically of the defendant, at what point are you going to be determining or, you know, considering the factors that were available to the defendant when he was applying force?
I'm sorry, could you rephrase that?
Yeah. So we know that there were some events that happened prior to Mr. Chauvin, the defendant's arrival on the scene, is that correct?
Yes.
Right. But for the purposes of your review of the reasonableness of the defendant's actions, at what point do you begin your analysis?
Based on when he arrived and he became involved in the actual use of force.
And so based on your review of the materials, what were the circumstances on the ground or at the scene for the defendant when he arrived?
When he arrived, after they removed him out of the vehicle and placed him on the ground, do you mean Mr. Floyd's actions or?
What did the defendant see when he first arrived on scene?
He saw Officer Lane and King struggling with Mr. Floyd in the back seat of the vehicle.
Okay. And then what did the defendant do after he initially arrived on scene?
He went to assist those officers with attempting to place Mr. Floyd in the back seat of the vehicle.
And did you observe the body-worn cameras then of various officers at that moment that the defendant approached the vehicle?
Yes.
Okay. Describe what you saw as best you can recall when the defendant approached the vehicle.
They were attempting to place Mr. Floyd in the back seat of the vehicle. Mr. Floyd was actively resisting, moving around. He was attempting to get out of the back seat of the vehicle. Clearly, he didn't want to be back there. And the officers were trying to initially place him in the back seat, grabbing the seat belts and things of that nature. And then ultimately, the decision was made to remove him from the vehicle.
Okay. Now, at the point that Mr. Floyd was removed from the vehicle, right, when he was taken out of the vehicle and brought to the ground, do you recall what happened? How did the officers proceed to remove him from the vehicle?
Yes. So they were pulling him from the driver's side passenger door, which is the street side, and they were pulling on his legs and his arms. And once they got him out of the vehicle, they somewhat placed him on his knees, or he kind of went on his knees.
And so now getting back to before he was placed or was attempted to be placed in the back of the vehicle, do you recall what Mr. Floyd was saying when the officers were trying to get him in the back of the vehicle?
Yes, he was saying that he couldn't breathe. He was saying he was claustrophobic and that, you know, he didn't like being back there.
Did you see him or did you hear him indicate that he had anxiety and that he was afraid?
Yes.
The answer is strictly.
And well, based on what do you recall Mr. Floyd telling the officers?
Numerous times he had stated that he was afraid. He had had COVID before and he couldn't breathe, and he had anxiety, and he was claustrophobic.
Now, based on those statements and the way Mr. Floyd was acting at the time, do you believe that what the officers did to try to get him in the vehicle in and of itself was reasonable actions?
Yes, it could be perceived as reasonable, yes. Okay.
But were there other alternatives that they could have done besides trying to force him into the back of the car?
Yes.
Is there any cause for speculation also beyond the scope of parameters?
Sustained.
Was it necessary for the officers to use force at that particular point?
Objection, cause for speculation.
Overruled. Not necessarily, no.
What else could they have done?
They could have continued to try to verbalize with him. It appeared early on.
I said overruled.
Please continue.
It appeared early on that the officer King had gained a slight rapport with Mr. Floyd early on. And so in police practices, it would have been best to try to continue to verbalize with him because he had gained a rapport with him, and try to get him to comply with his commands by verbalization.
But nonetheless, you believe, in your opinion, that it was not unreasonable for the officers to attempt to place him in the back of the car?
Correct.
And now I'd like to play a segment for you of what happens when they were getting him out of the car and initially placing him on the ground. So at this time, I'd like to publish the King body-worn camera, which is Exhibit 43. And I'd like you to please back that to 18 and 46 seconds. Yeah. Right, if you could play.
Kobe, man, I can't breathe. I
take
can't
a seat.
Leave, man. Leave this to me.
Is he going to jail?
Leave me.
He's under arrest right now for forgery.
I tell you.
Okay. Can we figure out what's going on?
Forgery for what?
Take him out.
For what? Leave, man. I can't fucking breathe.
Here, come on out.
Look at you. Thank you. Thank you.
Get up on the ground.
Yeah,
on the ground. On the ground.
And so at the point then they decided to bring Mr. Floyd out of the car, and you could see on the video Mr. Floyd was initially brought to his knees. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
And what did you hear Mr. Floyd say after he was initially brought to his knees?
I believe he said thank you.
Okay. And if you could continue.
Right. You got your Okay, restraint. Okay, hobbled. On the truck.
Can't
breathe.
Okay. I can't breathe.
I'll grab that. Jesus Christ.
I can't breathe. Okay, breathe.
Thank you.
Okay, breathe.
Stop moving.
Mama.
Stop. Thank you. Now, after he was initially on his knees and they began to put him to the ground, is that correct?
Yes.
What position did the officers place Mr. Floyd when they brought him on the ground?
Prone position.
And what is the prone position?
A prone position is where you lay a person on their stomach, the chest area.
And you can see that Mr. Floyd had already been handcuffed, is that correct?
Yes.
And so at this point, he is now prone on the ground, handcuffed, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Prior to him being in this position, did you see any aggressive actions or what could be interpreted as aggressive actions on the part of Mr. Floyd?
Prior to the prone position?
Prior to the prone position.
Yes.
Okay. What did you see?
He kicked his leg.
And could you describe that kick and how that might be interpreted by a reasonable police officer?
Yes, so the officers were still attempting to control Mr. Floyd at the time. And as they were trying to place him down in the prone position, I believe one of the officers was attempting to control his legs, and Mr. Floyd kicked their arms away in an attempt to try to possibly break free from the officer's grasp.
Aside from that one kick, did you see anything else in your review of any of the materials, the body-worn cameras, that would constitute an act of aggressive behavior by Mr. Floyd?
No.
And that was at approximately, 2019 and about 35 seconds, is that right?
Approximately.
And when we are evaluating then the restraint period, this is about the time we're starting, is that right? Right after he was placed on the ground prone.
Yes.
Did you hear the defendant ask a question regarding a restraint at that point?
Yes.
And what was he asking about?
I believe he asked for the hobble.
What is the hobble?
The hobble is a restraint that's used to bind a person's legs in order to control them better and stop them from either harming an officer or breaking property. In most cases, kicking out the windows of police vehicles.
And if I can show you, show the witness and not the jury. One moment, Your Honor. Witness Exhibit 200. Was that one received, Your Honor? 200. I'm going to ask you if you recognize what's shown in Exhibit 200.
Yes.
Does that appear to be the use of a hobble on a restrained person?
Yes.
Okay, I'll offer Exhibit 200 and ask to publish.
Any objection?
No objection.
200 is received.
And if you could publish, please. All right. Sir, is this the hobble restraint that you were referring to?
Yes, sir.
And when is this hobble restraint used?
Typically on someone who's actively aggressive towards the police.
And the person who you see in Exhibit 200, the hobble has been applied, what position is this individual in after this hobble has been applied?
The side recovery position.
What's the side recovery position?
Side recovery position is when you place someone on their either left or right side to assist them in being able to breathe better.
What's the purpose? Oh, I'm sorry. And you said it's to assist in being able to breathe better. Is that right?
Yes.
You familiar with the term positional asphyxia?
Yes.
What does that refer to?
It refers to when a person is in a prone position, and while they're in the prone position, they have a difficult time breathing, and it may cause death.
Right. If you could remove Exhibit 200. All right. Now, once the officers had Mr. Floyd on the ground in the prone position, and you can see that he was handcuffed, and I'd like to bring still image exhibit 255. That exhibit 255, that's approximately where we left off in the viewing of the video. Is that right?
Yes.
Once that has been done, the officers here after the kick had an assessment to make. Isn't that right?
Yes.
And that is whether or not they would continue to use the hobble or begin to use the hobble.
Leading and sustained. Rephrase.
What assessment did they have to use? Have to make at this point?
Well, based on the defendant's request for the hobble, they had to assess whether to continue to apply the hobble to the Mr. Floyd.
Okay. And based on your review, did they do so?
No, they did not.
What does that suggest to you regarding their assessment of the dangerousness or the need to restrain Mr. Floyd?
Based on my review, I would believe that they felt that he was starting to comply, and his aggression was starting to cease.
And was that consistent then with your own observations of what you saw Mr. Floyd do as the video continued?
Yes.
One moment.
All right, Lou, we're in another sidebar here, and it seems strange the state keeps excusing themselves to go. I'm not quite sure what he's doing.
It's hard to tell exactly, but they're using visual aids. They're looking at the clock right now. They could be talking about when they take this second break. But they're going piece by piece through the body camera video. And then, as he noted, it was Derek Chauvin who asked for the hobble, which is that restraint we saw in the picture being used of the person being demonstrated in the side recovery position.
Right.
We do know that they never ended up putting on the hobble. And so that's part of what's going to be scrutinized is if they chose not to use the hobble, why did they stay on top of him in that restraint?
Okay.
Members of the jury, we're actually going to break for the day. And the sergeant will be back tomorrow, and we'll resume with his testimony then. Let's shoot for 9:15 again, so the normal process. All right, thank you.
All right. Mm-hmm. All right, folks, we are going to just keep an eye just in case the judge decides mm-hmm.
yeah.
to come back here because we're breaking about an hour earlier than we normally would for court for the day, Lou. So that was kind of abrupt. We don't know really what happened in that last sidebar.
Because it was so abrupt, the jury's leaving the room right now.
Okay.
Perhaps the judge will come back and explain for the record why they're stopping right now. There may be some legal arguments that need to take place without the jury listening because that was... not an ordinary place to stop in the middle of a witness, especially this expert witness who presumably could go the rest of the afternoon here and be done by 4:30 or 5 o'clock. So, yeah, we'll have to see what happens here, but there was some sort of break. They asked for a sidebar. And then now apparently we're done for the day.
Yeah, it seemed a little bit like the state or the prosecution was not unorganized, but like I said, he kept having to break and walk away from the podium to go ahead and ask for some, you know, for, I don't know if it was evidence that they were looking at or things that they wanted to get admitted into the court. But it seemed kind of, the whole exchange seemed kind of odd.
Right. Let's go to our guests just to to get their take on it, because I feel like I'm kind of guessing at this point. Okay. So let's bring in A.L. Brown. He's an experienced defense attorney. And A.L., what do you make of what just happened at the very end there? Are we all just left to guess at this point?
Well, it's hard to tell, and I think we're all left to guess. But I agree with your assessment. That's an odd place to stop a questioning of a witness. You generally try to stop when the attorney has finished a particular line of questioning, or when the attorney has finished his or her questioning altogether, and it's time for the other side to have an opportunity to examine. So I wouldn't be surprised if Judge Cahill comes back on the bench and addresses some issue that may have come up in the testimony, but it's not a place to stop for sure.
And I'll sure interrupt here and send back to the courtroom if we do see that happening. But for now, I guess we can kind of review what we've heard up to this point. And another thing I'll keep an eye on is the report from the pool reporter inside the courtroom, who might have some additional insight as to what led to that break. But first, AL, this is their first national paid expert witness who's coming to testify about use of force. And it seemed that they started to use him for something that we were all kind of waiting for, which was to go through the body camera video and scrutinize these different decisions that were made along the way prior to them staying on top of George Floyd for 9.5 minutes. What do you think from what we've heard so far?
Well, a couple of observations. One, the purpose of an expert is to explain to the jury, the finder of fact, something that they cannot understand on their own. For instance, if you put most of us in the jury room and asked us to decide whether a heart surgeon had done a heart surgery correctly, we wouldn't have a clue because we are not trained in that way. But in this instance, when you're really trying to judge whether an officer used reasonable force, and you're looking at an officer with his knee on the neck or back blade of a person who died in that position, then I'm not quite sure the value of the experts at this point. And the cumulative effect at this point is just droning. And so, you know, prosecutors have a different job than defense attorneys, and they have a different perspective. But from this attorney's perspective, basta. As the Italians would say, enough.
And AL, just to point out that the feed from the court has actually officially ended.
Good observation. And we have an email here from the court communications saying that court will be back in session at 9:15 a.m. So it seems that they're done.
Yeah, so done for the day. And as you mentioned, again, we don't want to, basta, as you said, we don't want to beat this over the head. But obviously, this was a weird a thing to happen, a weird way to end the day here. But let's go back to something about this last witness, just talking about how the prosecution actually led him into talking about there was a struggle. So he did acknowledge that there was a struggle. He did was allowed to speculate on what maybe the police officers could have done differently. Do you feel like the state was able to get anything out of this particular witness with what we've heard so far?
Not so far, but I will tell you this. I'm hesitant to score this as it's a game just because there's lives involved and there's a community that's hurting one way or the other, no matter how this case turns out. And so I'm not into the scorekeeping, but as a matter of analysis, this is a day that the state needs to go back and regroup. Trials can be very taxing, psychologically, physically, on the family of all of these trial lawyers. And sometimes you can get lost in details and minutiae. If I were given free advice, and that's the cost of this advice, and that's probably what it's worth, it's to back up and see the forest. Stop trying to explain your case in a way that covers every potential defense. Give the defendants something to defend and not try to envelop their entire case in yours. You will have a chance to respond, but at this point, the use of experts on this point. And let me put it to you this way. I don't think the jury or the viewers learned much more about what happened on the day of George Floyd's death and the culpability of Officer Chauvin, or former Officer Chauvin, at the 3 o'clock hour than they had learned at the 11 o'clock hour.
All right. You know what? I just wanted to ask one more question, because you did mention the community, and that's what we do this for, right? We're broadcasting this for the community. And so I had asked a question earlier of one of our other experts about why the state is not doing more to show that the crowd isn't threatening. And we were told that that would be thought of as being cumulative and that the judge would object to that. So one of our viewers actually asked the question, if it would be cumulative for the prosecution to bring up the 9-year-old in the crowd as well as the other bystanders who were not threatening, why is it okay for the defense to keep bringing up the crowd? That's a valid question.
Yeah, well, you know, once the prosecution or the defense brings it up and it gets in, you've essentially opened the door. I don't understand. I think the state did make some efforts at trying to demonstrate that these folks were holding cell phones and therefore were only recording and not presenting any serious damage. But I'd like to, again, as I did earlier today, go back 3 steps before the use of force. Even the state's case seems to accept the notion that force was necessary. I can't wrap my head around this. This is about $20. Now, if there's a drum worth beating, if there's something worth repeating, it's that this case was about $20. The most that the store would be out of would be the $20 in the pack of cigarettes, okay? And so I don't understand why the handcuffs were needed. I don't understand why the need to put him in the car was required. Why couldn't you just walk up to him and say, Mr. Floyd, we understand that you've passed a bad check. Here's a ticket. Show up to court. And so even the state's case assumes that some level of force was required. Maybe that is a social conditioning we need to reckon with.
Right. Absolutely. That's a very good point. AL, we're going to take a quick break here, and then we're going to come back in just a few minutes with more analysis. We'll be right back.